communities throughout the United States and Canada. His background is in education, mental, behavioral health, community mobilization, strategic planning, and provisional therapy in individual and group settings. He has extensive experience working with administrative, corporate, and tribal management teams in establishing clearly defined and realistic goals. Mr. Flores provides training and consultation for tribal communities as they address the issues of domestic violence and family violence. He has provided technical assistance to the Office of Juvenile Justice and Delinquency Prevention Tribal Youth Programs for America, American, Indian, and Native communities. He has worked with the Bureau of Indian Affairs, law enforcement, and the provision of community-based policing and gang intervention. Mr. Flores conducts training for mentoring of for programs in the Oglala Sioux, the Lakota Nation, and the Boys and Girls Club of America in Native communities. He has led numerous youth leadership training and technical assistance for the Office of Native American Programs. He has served as Assistant Director of Student Special Programs at Mesa Community College in New Mexico and participated as faculty for the First Nation students at the University of Quebec in the field of social work. Mr. Flores holds a master's degree from counseling psychology from Arizona State University in Tempe, Arizona. He also has received extensive training from the Center for the Study of Person, Carl Rogers Institute, University of California, San Diego. What we find at MADAC is people with substance abuse, many times they came from traumatic events, and that's just what he's going to talk about, is the remnants of generational trauma from the people that have been to boarding schools and what the government had done 100 years ago to the Native American. So here we have Jacob Flores.
Thank you. Thank you, Marilyn. I really appreciate that. I also thank you, the residents here in Meskwaki and Sac and Fox community, that I've been blessed to come and visit with you, to become relatives with you. I always think about, you know, my journey. How did I get here? I'm from Tucson, Arizona. But right now it's 72 degrees, ladies and gentlemen. 39 degrees at night, 72 in the day. But my journey has taken me to the far reaches of Canada, to Mesticity. And I saw there what I see here. It took me to Nome, Alaska, and to the Remick Mission, where you can look across that body of water and you see Russia. And I saw there what I saw in Mississippi. I've been to Yellowknife in the Northwest Territories above Canada. And I saw there what I saw in Tucson, in Albuquerque, in Gallup, in Florida, in Minnesota, in White Earth. I saw there the remnant of a great plan. It was a plan. There was no mistake. It was done intentionally. It was done with forethought. And it was implemented with the dark spirit. And so when I come to these communities, And I see us still here as community indigenous tribal people. I say hallelujah to that. And I honor those people who had to withstand that type of treachery and planning, the fact that they hung on to that culture and to that way of life as best they could, even though we're wounded, we're still here. So with that, I want to honor all those grandfathers and grandmothers right now. I want to honor them. Just like our own mothers and fathers, huh? Like our own mothers and fathers, when we're little, we don't see what they do. We don't see it, do we? As grandparents, like I am now, we see our grandchildren. All they know from us is that, is there love? Is there safety? And can I trust this person? And so I'm going to give that to them. Because that's what they wanted to take away from us more than anything, is the safety our children felt with us. They took that away from us. And they created, and they injected us with a virus that is still, unfortunately, living in the way we live. But the sun is always there, though. So what I want to do tonight is to be realistic about what happened. And to open our eyes about what really happened. So therefore we can make a plan about where we're going to go. And I know that we will go to that good place because I see it. I see it. This is why I do this. This is Alexander Elijah Flores, my grandson. This is what motivates me. This is what tells me every time I hold that little boy in my arms and I put him to sleep or I spend time with him, that he motivates me to say, do your work. He calls me Tata. Do your work, Tata. And he looks at me and says, Tata, I love you, Tata. You're the best. You're the best, Tata. These babies will never suffer again in my eyes. And I see your young families. And I said hallelujah again, because I see these young families coming back together, and I see those babies being taken care of again. And that's the thing that's going to bring us back together here. So this great plan that was given to us was done over many, many generations of time. And I want to kind of bring us into a feeling of, what does it feel like to lose a child or to see a child that is in jeopardy? And I don't know if you remember this, but probably it's been about 4 or 5 months ago, there was a young child that had fallen into the cage where gorillas were in the Cincinnati Zoo. Does anybody remember that? And I remember seeing that on TV. And I watched it, and I saw this gorilla pulling this little baby around, completely helpless. And us, the people looking at it, are completely incapable of helping that baby. And it gave me a feeling of, I wanted to jump through that television and save that child. And the feeling that came to me on that moment was, that was one child that was in jeopardy. Ultimately, they shot and killed the gorilla. But it made me go back in time in the 1850s and the 1860s when that gorilla was dressed in the blue uniform of a Union soldier. And those babies were taken away from us. And they were taken to those schools. And for many of us, we didn't see them for many, many months or years, or maybe never again. But our children were taken away from us, and it tore the heart out of us as a community. A great woundedness began. And how do you heal that kind of a wound? How do you heal that? So there were two dynamics going on. The heartbreak of the children in the school, of missing their mothers and fathers, their grandmothers and grandfathers, and the heartbreak of the parents thinking about, what are they doing to my babies? So the woundedness surrounded us. And from a natural flowing river of life, the powerful natural flowing culture that we had, creative culture, in a river as it is, this moving and dynamic like our culture was and is still and will be more so, because that's the goal that will happen. We will become more and more dynamic. The river, whenever things happen to it, it cleanses itself because the water's moving. It's a natural cleansing process. What the plan said is that I want to take their children, I want to take their language, I want to take all this stuff away from them, I want to stop that river from running freely so that it will be dynamic and ever creating newness and cleansedness, and it will be a dynamic spirit. And they dammed us up. And they stopped our communication with each other. They stopped our culture. Everywhere they wanted, they stopped us. And we became like a stagnant pool of water. Is that it wasn't cleansing anymore. It wasn't dynamic anymore. We became wards of the state. Everywhere we turned, we were stopped. We were controlled. We were told when to get food, if we could hunt or not, where we could hunt. And this started to inbreed that hopelessness. And it was part of the plan. They wanted to create a culture of fear in us. And they applied the law of scarcity. This was demonstrated to me when I was in a community called Morton, Minnesota, in Lower Sioux, not too far from here. I went there to do some work, and I saw this old block house that was made out of rocks. It was sitting out there by the museum. And I went out there and I walked to that, and I kind of stood around there and looked. And then I went into the museum guy and I said, what was this for? He said, oh, that's the place where they applied the law of scarcity. So I said, what do you mean by that? He said, that was a food distribution block house, where every month they would bring food allotted for the people. And just for sake of numbers, if there were 100 families there, they made sure there was only enough food for 50 families. That was the plan. So every month when they began, people would come to line up and get their food, winter, summer. Now I want you to think about you and I being human beings right now, how cold it is out here, okay? And you're hungry, and you have children, and you have your elders with you, and you're going to get your food allocation, and there's no other way you can do it because you can't hunt anymore, because if you do, you'll be chased down and killed. That's what the Mankato hangings were all about. So you had to come and stand in line. So we were a family. So I would come in line and I'd stand in line. Well, there's four of us. Well, there's going to be four of you here. You can't collect for the other people. You've got to stand in line for them. So you would stand in line. And now the news got out that there was only enough food for 50 families. So what would you do as a family when the next month allocation came? What would you do? You'd make sure that you were in the front of the line. So sometimes they'd come 2, 3, 4 days a week ahead of time to get in line. This was planned by human beings. And there was a photographer that took pictures of this, and he was an Anglo, and I don't care about that. If you've got a good heart, if you've got a good spirit, welcome. This is not a blame game. But he took pictures of it, and then he wrote down on one of his pictures, from what seed did this great evil grow? Who thought of doing this to another human being? Because people would have to stand in line waiting for their food in cold weather until they got their food, and they were forced to do that. The law of scarcity. When you're hungry, you become marginalized. When you're hungry and desperate, some of your value is eroded. You know, a lot of these survivalist things that they have on reality TV now, the Survivor, and Naked and Afraid, or whatever. I don't watch Naked and Afraid. I don't watch that. I just watch the reruns. But it's all desperate situations that make you realize that you do desperate things. So that's why the law of scarcity wanted to do to us and to create fear amongst us, is that we need to feed our children and our families. So it made us desperate. So we took on the original, most profound PTSD qualities that we now hear in reference to our soldiers that come from Iraq and Afghanistan and from Vietnam. I'm a Vietnam veteran. It wasn't really that popular then, but they realized that certain things happen to people. And this was part of that disassociating ourselves from our circle and to become more focused on your own personal survival. I remember seeing this somewhere, and I thought it was appropriate. My eyes see it, my ears hear it, my mind has no place to put it. And we had to watch that happen to us. We who have been here for thousands and thousands of years, we had squabbles with other tribes, but we were not into genocide. And we had to watch the genocide happen to us. And somebody else was watching this too, that I'll talk to you about. An infamous character in our history. Somebody else is watching America do this to us. I love America. I'm a veteran. I think the United States of America is the best country in the world. But this is a history that has never been disclosed. This is a history that lies right below the earth and right out of sight. And I think that we as indigenous tribal people have to be aware of it so that it will motivate us to dig in a little harder when we're thinking about our children and our families, when we're thinking about that drink, when we're thinking about harming those people in our families and say, this is not who we are. This is not who we are. That we remember this. This great genocide, this Holocaust, the American Holocaust. The Holocaust of the Second World War, you can pretty much turn on the Discovery Channel or History Channel or whatever, and the anniversaries come, and it was a terrible thing. It was terrible. 6 million Jews, Polacks, mentally ill, gypsies, homosexuals, anybody who was different. We've seen the pictures of that over and over, but rarely do we see what happened to the indigenous people in our history. 8 million people, conservatively 40 to 50. Other people say over 120 million human beings' lives during our Holocaust. So then the 500 lies began. And we're going to make sure that you have so many millions of acres and you're fed this way and that way, and we're going to take care of you. The 500 lies. Every treaty. That's why you see people up here at the pipeline saying, yeah, we've heard this story before. And I honor those young people and all those people that are up there demonstrating against that, because it's an unnecessary thing. It's a minuscule amount of oil, this nasty crude oil that we don't need anyway, that we're going to ship across the world anyway. But it has to be done, because they've heard the 500 lies. Every treaty that we were a part of was never honored. They lied to us 500 times. So they only saw it on one side of their face, and then we started to realize that we were prisoners of this process, and the hopelessness began. And Chief Joseph of the Nez Perce tribe captured it very clearly. I'm tired of all the words that come to nothing. My heart is made sick when I remember all the good words and all the broken promises. There has been too much talking by men who had no right to speak. So the lie we felt, we feel now, we still feel lies, don't we? So the bottom line is that who do we have to depend on to heal ourselves? It's us. It's us. Our songs and our stories were silenced. We were pitted one against the other. There was a general that was in charge of controlling the renegades, the savages, you know. And one of his sayings was, when we pit them one against the other, our deed is done. When we pit you and I against each other, their goal is done. When we look at each other and say, I'm your adversary as opposed to your brother, his deed is done. So we all have to ask ourselves honestly, is the deed being done? And do we become a part of the virus? because it's based on fear and guilt, shaming, and anger. Because that's what fear is. When you're an oppressed people, ultimately, in order to process that stuff out of your spirit, it comes out easiest as anger. You just want to hit stuff. You even want things to hit you. I remember my son, he's 38 years old. He's a good man, he's got a good family. When he was 19, he was very angry. And I found him getting in a lot of fights. I said, "Jason, what are you doing?" He said, "Dad, sometimes I get so mad, I don't care if somebody beats the crap out of me or I beat the crap out of him." I said, where do you get this? It's like it was this time capsule thing that came out of him because we treated him well and he was never abused. I'm saying, where does this come from? So sometimes that anger, we don't want to express that anger, so we go medicate it. Right? We medicate it. We drown it for a while. We numb ourselves. We go into an alternative universe. But we always come back to reality. But unfortunately, too, is that many times when we medicate that feeling, it brings out the not good things. But it's easy and it's quick. Like, I would like to have this over with now. And I'll be honest with you, I want revenge. I do. I would like to be back there and get revenge. I would like to get revenge for what they did. But I know that wouldn't do me any good. And it wouldn't do my children any good. So I get that feeling of wanting to get revenge, to sustaining my effort, to bringing healing back to us, until us old guys can pass it on to you, young people. And then you understand clearly, you're just not in this spot in history. You represent way back there, way into the future. And you can never let your guard down. We never get there. Like AA says, one day at a time. Take care of your side of the street. Keep yourself healthy. Your children need you. Your family needs you. But don't ever let go of that nervous energy inside of you that says, if I let my guard down, it will not be good for my family. Don't ever get too happy. Always be vigilant. Always be a little bit angry. So now, this is what we're going to do right here. Instead of all this fear and anger, we feel it, it's going to motivate us. We're going to dig in and say, no more. And for many of our indigenous communities, tribal communities, our First Nations people, I like the way that sounds, the First Nations. It says, no more. Los Yaquis, I'm a Yaqui by birth, Lakota by adoption. Los Yaquis dicen, ya basta y sobre. And it's not great leaps. It's little pebbles in a pool of water, a pebble a day. Healthiness of spirit, mind, and body. Like I see you doing on your challenges now here. Like I see these young people who are taking care of their bodies and watching their diets, what they eat. Extracting ourselves from the commodity diet that those people gave us. The worst whatever it was, that's what they gave us. In Lakota, Wachichu means white person. Wachichu. But during this time, that definition of the word Wachichu was changed from white person to those who take the best part of the meat. That was Wachichu. Those who take the best part of the meat. And then they left us with rotted meat. And we were starving. Rotted meat with maggots in it. We were starving to death. And we learned how to deal with that meat to feed ourselves. Wachichu! That was a reality. That really happened. We just had a wonderful meal. We're going home to our homes. We'll turn the thermostat, huh? We're blessed. We're honored by those who hung on. But those who didn't have that, they froze to death on those marches. 1864, in Fort Defiance, the Dene Nation, Kit Carson, all right, American hero, cowboy, woo, Kit Carson, had movies made about him, murdering, terrible human being, slaughtering human being. They brought him to the Dene Nation, the Navajo Nation, because the Navajos wouldn't give up. So they told him, do whatever you need to do to make these people put their heads down. So in 1864, he applied the scorched earth. So the Navajos are very much affiliated with and tied to the herding of sheep and corn. So the first thing he would do is he'd get all the people around, huddle them up, bring all their sheep in, and slaughter the sheep. Kill all their sheep. Then he'd burn all their corn crops. And then they put them on a forced march from Fort Defiance for about 100 miles over the Pecos River and the Grand, forget what the other name of that river is, that goes through Farmington right there in the middle of the winter. They made a march in the middle of the winter in 1864. There were about 200 plus people. Many died. They drowned because they couldn't swim. They died of the cold. The plan. But we will apply consistency to our families. Be dependable. Be predictable. The most important thing that a child needs in their life is to have a parent, a grandparent, that's predictable. I know what my mama and daddy and my grandma and my grandpa are going to do for me. I can predict it. I can see it before I even see them. And it warms their heart. And it makes them feel safe. Like these little babies right here. Real live little babies. You're going to see their faces here in a couple minutes. Like this little man right here. Just this age. Take it from you. Right now. What are you going to do about it? It's like, shh, shh. And then he died. Most of all these children were taken.
Wounded Knee. Sand Creek. Colonel Shivington, that still has statues in Colorado.
The Great Indian Killer.
Colonel Shivington.
So this is a report that was made by somebody who was actually in charge of the Native people at Sand Creek.
They had already said, okay, we're good. Bring us food, give us protection. We'll do what you want. We don't want to suffer and die anymore.
But Colonel Chivington
masked his men and came in from Denver, Colorado. And this is the report. I was in hopes that our Indian troubles were over. I had 250 lodges near this place under my protection and that of Fort Lyon. All the chiefs and their families were in camp and doing all they could do to protect the whites and keep the peace when Colonel Chivington marched from Denver, surprised the village, killed one half of them, all the women and children, and then returned to Denver. Few, if any, white men can now live in near an Indian that doesn't want to kill them. Fort Lyon is in a direct road from the States to Santa Fe, and the commerce of the plains is millions each year. Chivington took 600 ponies, which were loaded down with plunder on his return. He has statues in Colorado, Colonel Chivington, the women and children. All of you are dead. You're dead. You were killed. This is what Colonel Chivington said. The heels of your boots for the children. The butts of your rifles for the women. The shot from your rifle for the men. That's what he told his soldiers. The heels of your boots for the children. I want you to think about that, because that happened. That really happened. Tomorrow you go to school. Dig in. Prepare. Go in powerfully prepared. Raise your hand. Go ahead and ask me what you want to know. Teach. I'm prepared. Be motivated by what these children went through. When I go to Oklahoma and work with young people, I did a lot of youth programs. I say, what do you think about that? I don't know. I don't know. I don't know. When I taught school in inner city Phoenix, had a lot of fun, awesome kids. Yavapai children from up in Prescott, living in a housing project. So I'd ask them questions to do this and that. I said, I don't know. I'd ask them questions at all. Two or three of them would. So then God touched me on my shoulder and said, next week on Monday, I want you to go in there after you take attendance. And I want you to just tell them to raise their hands. I said, what? Tell them to raise their hands. So Monday, we did the attendance. The kid runs the attendance to the office. That was back in the old days. And I said, okay, everybody, raise your hands. And they all go, what? Raise your hands. I made them raise their hands. Put your hands down. Every morning, I would come in we do the attendance, I say, raise your hands. Are you hearing me? Learn what it feels like to raise your hand. Now prepare, raise your hand for real, and put it on them, and express your power. Dig in. Ya basta y sobra. Enough is enough. So that other person that was watching the Great Holocaust was Hitler. He was watching the American army deal with us. He got it from two places. The English in South Africa with the Boer War, because the English were fighting the Boers, who were like Dutch people who went to South Africa, and they were farmers. But they found gold on those farms that the people, the Dutch people, were farming. So the English wanted that land because it had gold on it. So they've got all these women and children, put them in concentration camps. Starved them to death. Hitler saying, pretty damn good idea. In the United States, he watched us do forced marches, starvation, outnumber them by the military, massacre them. So he said, good idea. So the American army taught Hitler how to deal with the Jews and the Gypsies and the Polacks and the Russians. And the mentally ill. You understand what I'm saying? Remember seeing that stuff during the Second World War? How they dumped those bodies in there? That's maybe our great grandfathers and great grandmothers, great great grandmothers and grandfathers. And the brave soldiers. Right on, brothers. That's real. That's human beings. Every day you go to school, every time you think you want to take that drink, every time you want, your anger wants to move you to harming somebody in your family, every time you want to give up, every time you feel depression or hopelessness moving on you and saying, I can't do it anymore. You think about where you are now and what our great grandfathers and great grandmothers did for us to allow us to be here today. To have our communities. To have our casinos and hotels. All these different programs that want to help us with these issues. The fear that still lives in us. Don't you let this go to waste. Don't you let them get away with this. Or this. There's that little baby right there. Does that look like happiness to you? Does that look like happiness to you? Does that look like a nurtured, beautiful little soul? The older ones who have been there longer. Look at these tiny ones. They ain't taking care of the babies. They've been there for 10 years. They've become good stewards. They've learned how to survive the day. They used to have some of their older kids keep the younger ones in line, and they would get separate sleeping quarters, more food, less brutality if they kept the other little savages in line. That's what they did to us, to do to each other. I don't blame the kids. I say, what would I have done? I don't know. So there's woundedness that has happened to us. All wounds heal. The wounds of the body heal quicker, much quicker than the wounds of the spirit. The body is a resilient, wondrous organ and organism. Many of us have scars where we had wounds. And those scars are a remembrance of when that wound happened. But all they are now is scars. They don't even have feeling anymore. But they remind us of when you were in that car accident, or maybe when you were in that fight, or you fell off of this or that. And there's no feeling anymore in the wound, but the remembrance is there. And the physical body, when it has a foreign object that is harmful to it, enter it, it has spiritual innate knowledge of what to do to that foreign body. It immediately surrounds that foreign body with water, white blood corpuscles, and swelling to encapsulate that foreign, whatever it might be. For a lot of us, whenever winter was coming, we were out there cutting wood and whatever, and we were in a hurry. We didn't put our gloves on. We were grabbing for those sticks of wood, and we drove that thing up in our hand. Has that ever happened to you before? And that one was in too far. We couldn't get to it. We had to wait it out until about maybe 10 days, 2 weeks later. We were washing our hands, and there it came. And we got some tweezers and pulled it out. Because the body will do that for us. It expels foreign objects. That's why heart transplants in the beginning were so many failures, is because that new heart was a foreign body. And the body rejected it until they learned how to deal with it. The spirit body is different. The spirit body holds on to wounds for a long, long time. And the mind gets in the way of it, its own healing. So when we become wounded in our spirit, it becomes a great battle for us to cleanse ourselves. Because woundedness creates guilt. Woundedness of spirit also creates shame and fear. So even for those of us who come to you with a good heart and say, I want to help you, if you're not ready with your woundedness, it's not going to happen. So in this process that we're going through, of all these people that are working in all these different programs, they're saying, I'm here to help you. We say to them yesterday, and we say to them tomorrow, and throughout, be ever resilient and always be available and wait for them Wait for them until they're ready. Because you can't get sober because I want you to be sober. And man, do I want you to be sober. Because you don't understand, when you're not sober, how I don't sleep. I can't eat. I can't think of anything else because you're not sober. And I wonder what you're going to do, not only to yourself, but to others. And my life is taken away from you. But I can't do anything until you want it. So in our work as healers, we have to be ever vigilant. Get up tomorrow. Hang in there. Man. Screw them, man. Tired of waiting for you. But you gotta pick it up and you gotta go for it. Or you gotta tag team with somebody and say, hey, I'm tired, I can't do it right now. I got your back, let's go for it. Go rest, go sleep. Ever resilient until we get healed, until we balance ourselves. It's gonna come, it's coming. You see it coming. But when you're standing too close, it's like when you watch a little child grow, when you're there with them every day, you don't see them grow. Sometimes you look, dang, look at the child's growing so much. But if you're an auntie or whatever that moved away for about 6 months or a year, and then you come back and see the baby, what do they see? They see, look at the growth. Isn't that right, my baby girl? She raised her hand. That's right. She said, hallelujah. I'm sounding like an evangelical preacher. I don't know why I'm doing that. I hope I'm not channeling Jimmy Swagger here, but oh my God. I'm going to have to go to detox. Or Tammy Faye, what was her name, Tammy Faye? Well, I don't worry, Miss Carrie. There's this old movie here, for about another 10 more minutes here. The old Japanese movie called Tara, Tara, Tara. It was about the Japanese bombing Pearl Harbor. And boy, they came and they kicked our butts, you know. And boy, they annihilated that Pacific Fleet. And they were celebrating all over the place. And it was written there that Admiral Yamamoto, who was in charge of that whole fleet, was standing at the bridge, looking out at the bridge. And all his junior officers saying, why aren't you celebrating, man? We just tore up the Pacific Fleet of the United States. We ripped them apart. Why aren't you celebrating? And he said, because I fear that I have awakened a sleeping giant. You hear that? We have been a sleeping giant. We are a giant. We are powerful. We are resilient to have gone through what we have gone through as nations of people and still be here. That's resilience. That's power. Now it's up to us to sustain that effort and make it right and make sure that we consider our steps. Don't get in a hurry, but be resilient. Be every day. Take care of business every day and get it done right so we don't have to go back and make up because we were being too quick. There's an old saying that says, be quick, but don't hurry. Because when you hurry, you make mistakes. So when we elders pass on, we're passing it off to you, these beautiful babies. and your young families. It's our turn now, it soon will be yours. In a balanced life that has goodness and good spirit to it, I listen to the consistency of my world. My world is consistent. I see those things that are dependable in my life. I feel the predictability in my days. I sense the safety therein. I look forward to tomorrow. When you have become victimized, your world flip-flops. Not only do I sense safety, but I also sense threat. I become hyper-vigilant because I'm traumatized. I feel the energy and intent. I don't have to hear a word coming out of your mouth. I can see by your body language. I hear the fact that when you're coming home, you whistle that song when you're under the influence. I know that you're going to be not good tonight. So I start to protect myself. I feel the energy and intent. I smell those I can trust or not. You can sense and smell them. Us as caregivers, they're always smelling us and sensing us. The slight nuance of, is this safe or is this not safe? I see what needs to be done. I hear the direction I must move. I must be one step ahead or perish. That's why when you look at families that are abused families, they always have plans of, whenever you hear this happening, here's where you go, you run to your grandma's or auntie's, boom, boom, boom. So when that adult who's in charge of those children says to them, go, they know exactly where to go. They're like a well-oiled army platoon. They know exactly where to go. Because it's happened to them so many times. We need to get rid of that. We don't need to live our life like that. These are real children that I took pictures of with law enforcement. This little boy right here weighed about 110 pounds. You see those lines there with those things on the end? I don't know if you've ever seen a buckle that they call them roper's buckles, big old metal things like that. That's what that was. He came home, his mother was being beaten up by a boyfriend. He's 113 pounds, he's not stupid. He laid on top of his mom and took a beating. He was a gang member. Wonder why. Because that's where he got his juice. That's where he got his sense of being and power. Because he's been beaten ever since he was 9 years old, this kid. That little girl's 4 by 4.5 years old wasn't hit at all. That's what you call shaken baby syndrome. Shaken by her own mother under the influence of methamphetamine, when she wouldn't stop crying. We need to get rid of that. This is real. That child does not deserve it. So we learn to be hyper-vigilant. We learn to sense our world and always be kind of afraid. So I want us to have a little bit of that. I really do. It's not good to stand up to and say, I don't accept that. That's wrong. It's hard to do if it's only one of you. But if there's two of you or three of you, then it's more powerful. But don't let it just be one of us. Look at it in the eyes. See it for what it is. Because if we don't deal with it one at a time, ultimately it comes to our door. It comes to our door. I see your thoughts before I hear your words. A lot of the people that we are in the process of helping, that's exactly what they're doing when they walk in your doors. I see your thoughts. I'm going to check their thoughts out. I'm going to watch their body language. I'm going to watch the way their mouth moves when they say the lie or the truth. I'm going to watch them. There it is. It's a lie. You're lying to me. I'm out. You'll never see me again. Because maybe you were saying something that wasn't true, or maybe you were making a promise they knew you could never keep. And they're tired of having promises broken. They'd rather have somebody be real with them and say, I can only do so much, I'll be available, but you know what, I got my own family too, but I'll be available to you. And we start to build a relationship. We drop that little pebble of goodness and good spirit into that pool of water. Every day, just a tiny thing. Trust, safety. That's what they need most. It builds trust, autonomy, they become themselves, they see real purpose in their life, they identify themselves as people who are productive, people who can make an impact on life, they have fidelity, they know how to interact with people and be good human beings, they explore, they know how to love and to receive love. Everybody knows how to love and receive love, right? No, we don't. That was taken from us. To love and to receive love. Sometimes it's scary. And ultimately, if we do this right, we have wisdom and integrity when we get to be older people like us, some of us. I'm going to kind of close things down here, but I wanted to just share a couple of things with you. I was working up in a place called Hobima in Canada, Alberta, between Edmonton and Calgary. Little tiny rail stop on the railroad between those two big cities. I met a young man, but his name was Rick Yellowbird. Big, tall, 6'4".
Big, deep voice, talking guy.
Drug dealer. Kind of an outlaw guy when he was younger, came back out of prison to be a healer of his community. He says, I'm going to come back and I'm going to heal. And one time there was a lady there talking about how he said we should all listen to our elders to find the way. And Rick stood up. He stood up for about 2 minutes, he's so tall. When he finally stood up, he said, with all due respect, there are two ways you look at this. You look at Indian elders who lived a good life, paid attention, became wise. But on the other side, you have people who are just elderly Indians who didn't pay attention and live a good life. So when we say listen to our Indian elders, listen to the ones that lived a good life and provided that love and that place and that safety and that trust. And even after we raise our kids, we were raising those grandkids. And that gets tiresome, doesn't it, my brothers and sisters? But we did it because we had to, because we love them. "What do you mean you care?" he said to me, this locked up kid, Owen Camper. "What do you mean you care, man? What do you mean you care?" He's a gangbanger. He's always walked like this. "So." I said, "Is that part of the Tono Alto language? What's up?" "No, that's what's up." I knew him ever since he was 17. He's 29 years old right now. He has a little baby. He'll call me and say, "Hey, Jake, what's up, Jake?" I always know he wants something. "What's up, Jake?" And he texts. That's the only way they communicate anymore. I say, "What's up, Owen? What do you want, bro?" "We need some diapers." So I go down to Walgreens and get him some diapers. And I'll get him, because it's an infant, so I'll go get him some of the Similac, you know? I'll go get him the Similac and the diapers, take him down there. That's what I mean by when I say I care. It means I think about you after I leave you. It means I just don't deal with you and then forget about you. But that I have love for you. So I'm saying just one person that you can do that for means you plus that other person doubles us right in this room. Doubles us. To do a kind thing because it's the right thing to do. Because so many bad things have happened to us knowingly by people who are of dark spirit. Now they've all gone, but the spirit hasn't gone. It's still out there. Don't ever, ever think that that spirit ain't out there. Be ever vigilant. I'm going to zoom ahead here. It is not what we say, but what we do that defines our lives, our families, our communities, our world. Let us honor the value and treasure of our moments together. It's what we do. Many colors and hues are we, but we're all painted by the same spirit. And let's saddle up, huh? Let's go and kick some ass. Excuse my language for the babies. Let's kick some ass on getting healed up and getting well again and balancing our world again and opening up our eyes in the morning and saying, "Good God, it's morning." And then we'll say, "Good morning, God." So I want my young sister to come on up here and help me with the closure, okay? I want to say a couple of words. And I want to acknowledge Dara Jefferson, who I just met in October. And she does this work for a lot of these young people and these young women. And she's a wonderful writer. And I want her to share some of the words that she has put down, because her work motivated her to write this down. Beautiful words, so I'm going to have her read something for you, say some words to you if she would like to, okay?
Hello. I'm Dara Jefferson, for those of you who don't know me. I used to be an advocate with Meskwaki Victim Services for 4 years. I have recently transferred to the University of Iowa, where I still do work with our people and try to, you know, help us move forward in the same path that I think me and Jacob see. So, let's see. We've always done things to try to educate aesthetic little projects and whatnot. October is Domestic Violence Awareness Month, and one of the things I did was write stories to help people see what we do as, like every day in our jobs. I wanted to generate interest, have people ask questions, because the more that happens, the more discussions happen, the more dialogue we can create about domestic violence and sexual assault, and about healing our communities. So what I came up with was called A Day in the Life of an Advocate. And there were stories for me, and it came from a simple thought. I wanted my community to see a part of our job and a part of me that you normally would not have seen. I wanted to show you that I cared. I wanted to show you that you can trust me with your family and your friends. And I wanted to show you that you are important to me as a community, as clients, as people who decided to share your story with me. And even though I'm not an advocate with Meskwaki Victim Services anymore, I will always be an advocate for our people, Native people as a whole. I want to see our people heal and progress. Part of that is trying to become a healthy individual, because change does start at home. It starts with you and it starts with me. Healthy individuals create healthy relationships, and healthy relationships create healthy families, and healthy families create healthy communities. And that's ultimately the goal of what I'm trying to do, and hopefully the goal of what everybody else is trying to do. I wrote 8 stories. It was really hard trying to pick one, so Jacob picked it for me, because I couldn't. This one is called Lights. With every story, I try to focus on a certain part of our community. One was about men, one was about elderly, one was about children, one was, well, out of 8, there's 8 people. I can't remember them right now. But this one was specifically for the women in our community and the women that I work with. Light. I see you, the strong, beautiful, courageous, and fierce woman that you are. I met you. We met at the park and discussed life. We sat in a cafe and talked about dreams. We sit sometimes in a random parking lot or a side street, and I listen to your goals. I see you. I saw your light. I saw the day you came to me crying because the arguments wouldn't stop and the verbal abuse was taking its toll. I saw it that night that they drove you to find a place to stay because you found you and your children homeless once again. I saw it when you're unemployed and struggling just to get to the next day without breaking down. I saw it when your body was covered in bruises and all you wanted to do was sleep. I even saw it the day you felt like everyone and everything was against you and your hope was dimming. I see you. Though some days are still a struggle, you still fight to move forward, carrying the weight of your world. I see you. When your heart is broken and still breaking, but you keep trying because you believe in family, even if it kills you, I see you. When your own family quit helping you a long time ago, but yet here you are, surviving, I see you. Our women are afraid to cry. They are determined to suffer in silence because somewhere along the way they were taught that emotions were a sign of weakness. They use anger as a defense and build walls around themselves. Asking for help makes them feel less than. Our women are hurting. Nobody ever told them that it was okay to cry. I taught them to scream if they have to, just get it out. That pain, that anger, that bitterness, it'll eat you alive if you let it. They are judged, they're blamed. They feel shame, embarrassment, and guilt. They're called names and they're made fun of. They grew up here their whole lives and they're made to feel like they don't belong. Out of 100 respondents in the domestic violence survey, 85 of them were from the Meskwaki community. Of that 85, 93% have been affected by domestic violence in some way. 93%, our people are hurting. So be kind, be gentle, be light. But just to give you a visual of about what this looks like. Kim, Marilyn, are standing up. Jason, can you stand up? Stand up. The other Jason, can you stand up? My Jason, can you stand up? So we got what? We got three over there. We got two right here. Wendy, stand right there. Cheyenne, can you stand up? And we got two. Okay, three, four, five, six, seven. Everybody that's sitting down represents people that said yes, that they were affected by domestic violence in some way, either by either them or somebody that they knew. This is our community right here. This is how many people were affected by domestic violence. And this is what we need to heal. Thank you.
Your thoughts before I hear your words. I knew that about this girl. First time I saw her. This is a strong woman. Lots of us in here. I will extend my hand to you, Shirley, as soon as I will soon reach for yours. We all need help. And it's kind of like getting a flat tire on the side of the road, you know? Look, all those people aren't stopping to help me. Remember when you were the one in the car? And you went right by the person who's going to die? It never impacts us until we're the one. Until we're the one. Until we have the family member that has an alcohol problem or there's an issue of violence and we go looking for help and we can't find it. Until there's that one person that stands out and comes out of the crowd and says, I see you. Come with me, I'll help you. We all need a helping hand. I just want to read this as a closure for that young woman, that young family that kind of suffers. This is a compilation of a lot of different young people, young families that I've seen. There's a couple of lines in here about my sister as well. And my grandson, my nephew, I should say, who passed away at the age of 42 because he drank himself to death at 42. Drank himself to death. It was suicide by alcohol because he couldn't deal with the anger and abuse that he had suffered as a child. I think of her wondering why she deserves this. I think of children worrying about their mama while at school and teachers seeing no hope for them. I think of children listening to the thumps on the wall in the next room, frozen with fear. I think of them not having enough to eat, holes in their socks, others noticing and making fun, not wanting to go home. I think of her son wanting to protect her and to get revenge and spreading the virus of hate. I think of her knowing he will soon be getting out. I think of her, the mother, remembering when she was new and fresh and how it came to this. I think of her just wanting to rest because all is well and knowing